We all knew that electronic identification and trust services for authentication and signatures would eventually become ordinary, everyday technologies in the EU and across the world. It's just been taking time to figure out and evolve how individual nations that are contributing to things like a coalition of EU member states are implementing these technologies and laws so that it works for everybody and works for the countries around them as well, which immediately makes it more complicated. eIDAS, if we just go back somewhat to think about where we came from, is actually not the first EU initiative to address trust services. It all started with the Electronic Signature Directive, which was passed in 1999, which for the first time allowed countries to recognize electronic signatures as the equivalent of handwritten signatures. Not only was this adopted or allowed by the member states of the EU, but it was pretty much adopted by countries around the world, as this was groundbreaking at the time to take a framework like this, and which has got a legal aspect to it, and allow technology to bridge this gap. The Electronic Signature Directive was supposed to encourage the use of electronic signatures across the EU between member countries as well, but it fell short of the goal. The biggest problem was that it didn't really define common standards, technical standards. You know, so each country could accept digital signatures and they brought out their own mechanisms for signing, but they were totally incompatible with each other. So it made it de facto impossible to conduct cross-border electronic transactions, which was really the intention of the directive. Another problem at the time was that they focused on high security or state of the art at the time in the form of smart cards and these USB crypto fobs. You know, and we all know that it's very difficult to use technology like that because there are drivers and things involved that have to be loaded on your machine. But the biggest problem is you can't really use it with your mobile device, you know, which is really where the world has moved. So we had this massive consistency problem, and it was clear that some more specific guidance was needed. You know, that is really where eIDAS came from then, is that the EU established in 2016 a new interoperability framework for national electronic identity schemes that could be used cross-border. It went beyond what the directive did with defining types of electronic signatures, but it also had specific guidance around cloud-based signatures or remote signing for the first time, which was incredibly valuable. There were trust services such as timestamping defined, certified email, website authentication, the different types of authentication and identification mechanisms and their levels were described. But after all of this, there was still low interoperability between the countries regarding these eID solutions that they were implementing. And one of the reasons for that was the local interpretation of the law limited the use of foreign services in a local market. And it never went away that there was always a low level of education and understanding of trust services as an efficient tool for securing paperless transactions, but actually just doing better business. You know, the dots weren't joined sufficiently with education mechanisms. I think a small thing as well was the first version of the eIDAS also didn't cover electronic attributes. You know, and quite often this is a requirement to do a remote onboarding process. You know, you need to prove where you live, for example, or you need a medical certificate, or you need to show your demonstrate your professional qualification. You know, and because it didn't really have that, or it didn't allow for that, it wasn't as useful as it could have been. I think finally, and this really leads into where we should be taking it, is that the user wasn't at the heart of the matter either. You know, that was not really thought of in eIDAS 1.0. Citizen acceptance of the eIDAS 1.0 was low, and I think there's a few reasons for that. Some of them along how useful was it to a citizen, and the other thing is, did they trust it? You know, I think we touched on it in a previous question, but eIDAS didn't cover the provision of electronic attributes such as medical certificates, qualifications, and these are things you often need in an onboarding process. You know, so if you couldn't do that electronically and in a trustworthy manner as well, you know, you couldn't really completely do the onboarding process. I think a more important thing, especially in Europe, is the issues of security and trust. You know, the user was not able to control the exchange of data in any kind of verification or onboarding process. You know, and I think that is specifically important for everybody to know that they're in control of providing their data to somebody. A big thing as well is just the time that it takes in order to change the way business and law runs, how it operates. We needed this consistency and alignment of relying parties. You know, and what I mean by relying parties is an organization, let's say a niche investment bank. You know, it doesn't help if their individual users decide they are going to sign something with a qualified signature and send it to the bank if the bank is not actually geared to receive a qualified signature and to verify the qualified signature. You know, you can stand on your head, but you are not going to get them to change their process, because until they're ready to change the process, because they've got to be audited. You know, there's so many controls in changing, you know, so that definitely takes time. And then not only the user has to trust it, but also the bank needs to trust this. And we always have paper as a backup, so there's always another way that you can do it, especially in companies where they appreciate high customer intimacy, you know. So I think that was all factors contributing to a rather low take-up. The relying parties couldn't always adopt these processes because they're looking at, is this going to be successful in cross-border transactions for me? That is a massive thing to go and investigate, and they were just very slow in doing it. There's a lot of talk at the moment around what are the main differences between eIDAS 1.0 and 2.0. But the most important thing for me is eIDAS 2.0 really comes with a lot more security. You know, security is a core aspect of the eIDAS 2 regulation, both from the perspective of citizens that are going to be doing online transactions and the businesses that are offering their services online. You know, so it's a big step forward. They've considered things like a unified technical architecture, you know, in this reference framework, along with all the correct standards, you know, so that it's crystal clear, so that everybody knows exactly what to do, and you can eventually interoperate between countries. This avoids fragmentation, you know, makes sure that there's a proper ecosystem this time, so that digital identity and trust services like digital signatures can be recognized and accepted all the way through the EU, and probably even in other countries as well. Very interesting though, there's also an extension of the list of trust services beyond what we had in the previous eIDAS and directive. So we're looking at services now like electronic archiving services, electronic ledgers, the management of remote electronic signing devices, the creation of electronic stamps. So it's very interesting that there's new services that can be offered by the QTSPs. It is exciting that the eIDAS 2 regulation has gone a step further by proposing a digital identity that can be controlled by citizens through a wallet on your mobile phone. You know, I think this is a very exciting thing for citizens. It'll have very high levels of security, and your identity and the details of your identity very similar to what's on an ID card that you find in Europe, not in the UK, will be in this identity, but you'll be able to control when you provide these details to an organization in an onboarding process or a strong authentication so that you can act on a system. There'll also be the possibility of having many other personal attributes. You know, it could be your address, it could be your driver's license, it could be, in some cases, your proof of bank account. It could be health information that COVID taught us was so important. It could be academic qualifications. You know, there's a whole new potential to do these attribute assertions into the future that are actually useful for people and useful for businesses. So eIDAS 2 is also setting very high standards for providers of identity services and providers of trust services, which you typically see in authentication and electronic signatures. And this is going to push up the overall level of security available to businesses and organizations. So definitely there's going to be a big benefit in the secure ecosystem for businesses that are using and relying on identity and signatures. This translates into less risk, you know, this translates into competitive benefits for businesses that are adopting this. They can save costs. If we think of ESG, you know, electronic signatures, electronic archiving is a very strong contributor for a business in that space. We're also going to have the wallets, which are going to definitely, for the first time ever, I believe, completely revolutionize or finalize the revolution of onboarding processes. In the banking system, for example, where they have got regulations of AML, KYC, but even in corporates where you are onboarding people, you can mitigate many of the risks by actually relying on the identity in the wallet. You'll understand immediately that this customer has got good security in the technology that they're bringing, but the identity and the assertions of the attributes have all been verified very strongly, and you can trust the signature that comes with these. You know? So that is really a very complete solution that's going to make it so useful. The citizens are also going to be able to use the wallet for two-factor authentication, two systems. And this will allow them to access systems. It'll also allow them to access remote signing or cloud-based signature infrastructure, which is already there, so that you can benefit from things like an independent timestamp in the signature. You know, so it's going to definitely play a role for the citizen in strong authentication, as long as the relying parties correctly set up the infrastructure to allow for this. These sophisticated mechanisms for authentication are actually going to allow all citizens to digitally sign documents. And, you know, we used to call it the gold standard of signing is qualified electronic signatures. If you look at what's in qualified signatures, it's really a strong authentication mechanism along with identity checking. And I think that's not really the gold standard anymore. That's just the fundamental standard. We have so many attacks and there's so many fake things in the world. How can you possibly want anything less than that coming into your business? The new qualified trust services is actually a change in thinking for QTSPs. You know, businesses and governments need a partner for data authenticity in all its forms. And the QTSPs are well positioned and they're well skilled to fulfill this role, you know, for this requirement that there is as a data authenticity and identity authenticity partner to business and government. You know, there's enormous potentials in Europe because everybody is so digitalized. You know, there's 87% of the users use the internet, you know, almost 60% use online banking. So there is a massive market that is using their mobile phones and the internet. And the new services can be offered to them, you know, electronic attribute attestations. These can be provided by QTSPs. When eID is migrated into the mobile wallet, you know, there's opportunities to allow people to do things like display their mobile driving license, you know, to authorize payments. We mentioned earlier using it as two-factor authentication. They can very definitely sign documents electronically, authenticate to the remote signing service or the cloud signing service to get a very good, high-quality qualified signature. They can open a bank account. You can maybe even show your ticket to a football match eventually, you know, but I think there'll be so many useful parts of the eIDAS 2 that QTSPs can play a role in. Maybe let's just highlight one of them, and that is the definition of electronic archiving, which is in eIDAS 2. It allows QTSPs, typically, which is what we're talking about now, to provide this service that allows for the receipt, storage, retrieval, deletion of electronic data and documents in a system that preserves the integrity and confidentiality throughout the period that is intended for preservation. You know, so there's very specific wording in parts of the articles of the eIDAS too, which allows for qualified trust service providers to do qualified electronic archiving. You know, and that really is the opportunity for this new solution. And of course, as always, there will be a presumption of the integrity of the document for the duration of the preservation period if it is a qualified service. Ascertia, now part of the InfoCert Nexta group, has always been well positioned to support the market with the best trust service solution infrastructure possible. The design of Ascertia solutions has always been to offer hybrid deployment models, which can be on-premise or it can be a private cloud solution. And this can cater for sovereign or high security solution requirements, or even create local business models for a QTSP, as an example. There are solutions in the portfolio like Common Criteria Certified PKI, digital certificate management solutions, our remote or cloud signing infrastructure, which can be added to a QTSP for document signing, data signing. We offer time stamping infrastructure, all these building blocks that can be used to create solutions. But we understand every organization is going to have a unique requirement and they're going to be at a different state of adoption or business model. And that's why we look at customers' existing investments and we augment their capability in order to give them a complete solution in the shortest possible time with the quickest possible return on investment. You know, and again, everybody's going to be at a different place. Some organizations are already QTSPs, they have got solutions, but the infrastructure is aging. It could be legacy, it's becoming legacy, it's becoming expensive. You know, they need newer solutions like document signing solutions, which are flexible and they can meet the customer requirements. You know, and that's where Ascertia is so good to work with organizations to deliver these all the way through to adding on the new and exciting solutions we've been talking about, like document archiving and preservation, electronic register delivery services. And the way we do it is we take care of all the things that need to be taken care of. You know, we've got quantum computing knocking on the door. And the Ascertia solutions include things like crypto agility, you know, so that we can weather the storm of post-quantum crypto. All the while, we're looking at helping organizations implement a zero-trust approach, you know, so that their business models and their customers can survive cyber criminals and the cyber warfare threat that's just part of our lives today. You know, so I really believe that eIDAS 2 is this legal trust anchor that we need for the digital age. And organizations like Ascertia that are passionate about this, you know, really should be part of every conversation around digitalization and the future of organizations.